Troops from Zimbabwe on patrol in Mozambique. The frontline states are in peril, their economic arteries under threat from sabotage by South Africa. Tonight, This Week examines the price of sanctions in the corridor of power.
Good evening. Over the last few months, it's become ever more clear that the frontline states in Southern Africa really are in the firing line. Nations like Zimbabwe and Mozambique have committed themselves to sanctions against apartheid, but today their very survival as independent states is dependent upon South Africa. In its starkest form, this basic fact raises the question, how do they assist the destruction of apartheid without destroying themselves? In Corridor of Power, Trevor Phillips reports from two nations in jeopardy.
Sunset on Beira Beach. Once, this was Mozambique's Indian Ocean playground for the rich. Today, refugees squat in abandoned hotels. The city has no water supply, no shops, no buses, no medicines. Meat and petrol are rarities. Beira is just one victim of a calculated campaign by South Africa. Its object, to humble its black neighbors. Its weapons, sabotage and economic chaos.
South Africa has been in a program of destabilization of neighboring countries for years. Between 1980 and 1984 alone, in the earlier part of the period, the cost of that destabilization was something like $10 billion, one-third of the total export earnings of all of those nine countries. So this is a massive program designed to keep those countries in a position of economic and, of course, political dependency on South Africa.
We are suffering, and we are suffering a lot already, without a single measure of sanctions being imposed against South Africa. If you tell me that the blasting of sleeping Botswana in the middle of the night is not suffering, the blowing up of railways and roads, the burning of oil terminals and blowing up of oil refineries, the fostering of bandits who are cutting people's ears and people's noses, burning schools and clinics and hospitals, shutting up rural stores, as you saw in Beira, is not suffering, then I don't know what is suffering.
This is Southern Africa's economic battleground. With few roads and vast distances to cover, most trade in this region has been rail-borne for nearly 100 years. In colonial days, goods bound for Europe traveled via the most convenient coastal port. Landlocked Zimbabwe and Zambia tended to use Mozambique, but in the past 10 years, their trade has been deliberately channeled into South Africa's ports. In part, they've been tempted there by the carrot of cheap rates on South Africa's freight trains, but they've also been chased south by her military stick. South Africa's neighbors were all friendly British or Portuguese colonies until the 1960s. By 1980, independence movements had created a bloc of nine hostile African states. To neutralize this political threat, Pretoria played the transport card. In a series of sabotage raids, South African-backed forces destroyed every non-South African rail route to the sea, except those too long or too dangerous to use. The 6:30 a.m. goods train from Messina in South Africa to Beit Bridge in Zimbabwe. The trains that cross this bridge carry more than three-quarters of all Zimbabwe's trade with the outside world. Beit Bridge is by far and away the country's most important trading link. And it's kept open only if the South Africans want it open. It's not just the scale of this trade that matters to Zimbabwe. The 630s carrying lubricants for the country's tractors, chemicals for its soil, machine parts for its factories. Without them, Zimbabwe's economy will grind to a standstill within days. Zimbabwe has to pay $25 million each year to its bitterest enemy just to keep this traffic going. And the country's leaders know that South Africa has their economy by the throat.
At any time, they can strangle us I can give an example. When the 10 round of trends between us and South Africa was once at 13 days, and then they increased it to 18 days. They increased to 40 days. But after some discussions with them, they have now reduced down to 18 to 20 days. But under Smith, it was 13. So you can see that it is necessary for us to move away from that situation where, by the stroke of a pen, they can lengthen the 10 round of trends.
To pay for its imports, Zimbabwe has to sell its products abroad. And those exports are just as vulnerable. Six of Zimbabwe's main export products depend on South African ports to get to their market. Grain exports earn upwards of $40 million a year. Sugar, steel, minerals and meat bring in another $400 million. Cotton is worth more than $100 million each year. Between them, they account for two-thirds of the country's export sales. That means that $2 out of every $3 of foreign currency earned by Zimbabwe depends on South African goodwill. Exports of meat to Europe are especially vulnerable. A delay in dispatch can lead to huge refrigeration costs. Even worse, a hold-up on the line can mean that a whole shipment perishes. The industry's bosses understand the costs of a confrontation with South Africa only too well.
I think we would see massive unemployment. Major industries would virtually come to a halt. Export earnings would fall fairly dramatically and quickly. Even institutions such as the railways would find it difficult to operate because of a shortage of essential lubricants. And products which we don't produce ourselves and which we currently import either from South Africa or through South Africa. Coking coal, for example, for the refining of ferrochrome.
For Zimbabwe's businessmen, the search for new routes to the sea is now the number one priority.
For us, as business people in Southern Africa who are here to stay, and we are Africans, it's not an option. It's absolutely critical. Especially, I think, when you take a long-term perspective on the South African situation, because there's not going to be substantive change in the South African crisis for many years to come. And while South Africa is going through this metamorphosis, we have to survive. And this is exactly what we're doing. We're making sure of it.
This is the alternative, the rail line from Mutare in eastern Zimbabwe down to Beira. It's Zimbabwe's quickest and cheapest route to the coast. Less than 200 miles to the east of here lies the Mozambican port of Beira. If the frontline states want to break through South Africa's domination of the transport system, it'll be through this valley behind me. They regard it as their gateway to economic liberation. But the question is, can they make it work? The Beira line isn't a new route. Built by Cecil Rhodes in the 1890s, it once carried more than half of Rhodesia's trade. But since 1975, when Mozambique closed its borders to Ian Smith's rebel colony, there's been little traffic. Under Robert Mugabe, Zimbabwe has gone all out to reopen the line. Its backers say that charges would be half those on the South African routes. But the railway isn't the only important part of the corridor. Alongside runs a road used by service and military vehicles. And below the soil is a vast oil pipeline, pumping 50,000 barrels of petrol and diesel per day, 95% of Zimbabwe's entire fuel consumption. With so much at stake, it's not surprising that the Zimbabweans are prepared to defend the corridor in numbers. Mozambique's National Army, the FPLM, proved incapable of preventing five successive major attacks on the pipeline in 1984 and 85. So in July last year, the Zimbabweans took over. They moved in up to 12,000 troops, highly trained and well equipped. Above all, they were experienced in guerrilla warfare. They've kept the corridor open, but in spite of this huge commitment of forces, it's still not risk-free. In the past month alone, explosions have halted rail traffic twice. And even the presence of armed guards on top of and inside the wagons hasn't kept the trains running on time. Earlier this year, the destruction of this bridge on the Pongwe River made the road impassable until engineers could put up a temporary crossing. In August last year, their headquarters at Gorongosa were overrun by the Zimbabweans. These diaries reveal the depth of South Africa's support. The MNR was promised arms and training by South Africa's military leaders. The object, to bring economic chaos to Mozambique. This cement factory near Beira was part of an industry that earned Mozambique $5 million US a year. The MNR destroyed the rail link to its quarry. Today, Mozambique imports cement. Where from? South Africa.
Power lines, railways, bridges, systematically attacked and destroyed, weakened, so as to turn the traffic through South African routes and enlarge the dependency. So it has to be a very important part of the immediate need. And it is a great humanitarian need. It's not part of a fight against South Africa. It's a part of helping the basic needs of the people of those frontline states, of Zimbabwe, of Zambia, of Mozambique, perhaps most of all, to sustain. Most of those countries other than Mozambique are landlocked, to sustain an outlet to the sea, in this case, through Mozambique. So the Beira Corridor, the Beira port itself, are all part of what should be a major international effort to secure these important transportation links.
When I was a journalist in Maputo in 1983, the South Africans did an air raid of Maputo. And it was clearly a surgical demonstration raid. They attacked a jam factory. And they strafed the jam factory, they strafed the creche at the jam factory, they killed workers coming to work in the jam factory. They said it was an ANC terrorist base, but I arrived there literally while the bodies were still on the ground, and there were all that you could see were grapefruits and tins of jam. This wasn't an ANC terrorist base. They were attacking a jam factory to demonstrate to the Mozambicans the power they had. About three streets away from the jam factory, they attacked the house of the head of the state advertising agency. And it was like target practice. The planes came in low over the trees and just with rockets attacked the back of the house, blew away the entire back of the house, and then went up again. All they were doing was a kind of target practice to say to Mozambican civilians, we can get you if we want to get you.
Commercial Transport Matari, one of the few trucking companies still prepared to risk the road to Beira. Don Howard, the owner, is carrying medicines and food to the besieged town.
We have had one or two incidents in the last 2 months. One vehicle detonated a landmine with the rear end of the vehicle. We can't tell who are causing problems along the road. The risk is always there on any road.
Howard can't get his vehicles insured for the route, but he insists on going because he believes that the future of his business depends on keeping the road to Beira open. This is what he's pinned his hopes on, Beira Port. Back in the 50s, Beira handled more than half of Zimbabwe's exports. When the border was closed, it lost that business. But it's slowly coming back to life. European governments and private companies have put more than $300 million US into rebuilding. And they've sent their own engineers to get the job done. The port's capacity is up to 1 million tons. And its backers predict that inside 3 years, it will be able to ship as much as the frontline states can send. But there's still a long way to go. Beira itself is a town under siege. It's been cut off from the surrounding countryside by the MNR. There's no water supply and no power in the city. No shops are open because there's precious little to sell. In fact, money has little meaning here. Beira has gone back to the barter system. The MNR haven't gone away, and the squeeze on Beira continues. Graham Evans is a British engineer working for BP. He's been here since 1984.
We've been without water now 6 days. It started last Tuesday, it's now Sunday.
And what is the problem?
The problem, they tell us, is that the pumps have broken down at a place called Matua, 40 kilometres up the road. They're trying to repair that. They're trying to bring in generators. We've shipped some generators up there with a crane, which happens to be working for us. They might get that repaired next week.
Electricity, how long have you been without that in Beira?
86 days now. It went off on the 25th of August. They originally cut the power on the 11th of August, and that was off for 8 days. They managed to re-establish the lines were blown up, and then on the 25th they were blown up again, only this time apparently the bandits also cut the power cables. Very difficult to repair. They haven't been repaired since.
A water queue, the most common sight in Beira. Unless you can manage to collect rainwater in a roof tank, you can't afford to waste water here by washing in it. And the stench of untreated sewage and rotting garbage follows you through the streets. Fruits and vegetables grow in rich profusion, but no one can buy them. The average weekly wage will get you just 2 cabbages. And to buy $1, you'd need a bucketful of Mozambican meticals.
Mozambique is the front line of the front line states. That is where the first act of protection and security must take place.
So if those countries requested it, you would support the idea of military aid from other countries?
Yes, I think so. Already, but you know, we've passed that. Zimbabwe is already engaged, inevitably, militarily, in helping to protect that Beira corridor. It has to be, because it's its lifeline.
Do you see any prospects of military help from other countries, let's say India, for example?
Well, I think all of that must be possible. Much of it must depend on what the frontline states themselves want.
Wouldn't there be a case, as the Commonwealth Secretary General, Mr. Ramphal, says, for international help of a practical kind, by which he means troops?
Well, let me make it absolutely clear. Any incursion by the South African Defence Forces into Mozambique, Zimbabwe, or any of the other frontline states is totally and utterly unacceptable. And I'm quite sure that world opinion would combine, under such a circumstance, to take the most appropriate action in the circumstances. But I'm not prepared to speculate as to what that will be. I'm sincerely hoping that somehow we're going to knock some more sense into the South African government to stop these incursions onto frontline state territory.
With the example of Mozambique before their eyes, the frontline leaders are sceptical about a change of heart in Pretoria. At last summer's Commonwealth mini-summit, they chose a different, more risky road to try to bring about the fall of the apartheid system itself with an international campaign of sanctions.
The South African government is fighting its own people, and we must not be seen as the major protagonist or antagonist in the apartheid battle. It is a battle between a regime which is illogical, irrational, and racialist against its own people. And we just happen to be the pawns, the unfortunate victims of a regime which is running away from its own self-made problems at home and looking for scapegoats outside.
But you are prepared to take the consequences of a sanctions battle.
What is the alternative? To live under perpetual domination? Under perpetual bandit activities, with our populations being subjected to victimization, humiliation, and torture, there's no alternative.
But Linda Chalker knows that to work, a sanctions policy would have to involve South Africa's largest trading partner, Britain. Would we join the campaign?
Trevor, I must ask you to look at what has happened, even with the limited sanctions which are in place in South Africa in the last 4 months. The South African government has built itself into a lager situation. It is seeking to do far more negative things in the line of apartheid because it has literally fenced itself round. It is making itself even more self-sufficient, and it is being even less open-minded towards black South Africans. More sanctions would make that even worse. And one of the reasons I'm quite certain that the frontline states have not yet taken all the measures to which they committed themselves back in August is because they've realized how desperate this would be in many areas for them. They may still take those sanctions, and I don't presume to say they should not. But I do not believe the West, by taking general economic sanctions, will do anything to advance the cause of black South Africans.
Sanctions are imposed. This may shorten the time between this suffering and the independence of South Africa, the majority in South Africa. But Margaret Thatcher would want us to continue suffering quietly.
Will you implement sanctions against South Africa?
Our Prime Minister is an honest man. What he says, he does.
And what is your plan now, given the list of sanctions drawn up by the Commonwealth in the summer and so on? What are you planning to do?
We are waiting for the signal and we implement.
But who are you waiting for?
The signal from the Commonwealth.
Every day that the frontline states wait, their dilemma deepens. They could try to go ahead with a sanctions campaign, but the costs, human and economic, would be fearful. And without Britain's backing, they'd be unlikely to succeed. But if they fail to carry out their threats, their credibility will suffer, and they'll be sending a clear message to Pretoria. That in Southern Africa, for the moment at least, apartheid calls the shots.
Trevor Phillips reporting from the turmoil in Southern Africa.